The topic that we have chosen for this session is the digital supply chain for banking. So it's an outcome of experiencing the benefits of API-driven open banking, as we call it. So a lot of introduction to open banking has already been done. Johan spoke about it. Dasan also spoke about it today. Mifan also spoke very very well about open banking and how it has helped. And I'm going to be extending, and I'm going to be talking about what we have experienced as part of open banking, primarily learning from the experience where we have implemented open banking using WSO2's open banking components. This is what we have done. So we are in the final stages of go live. We have completed all the development ready for go live. We should be going live in a few weeks, or probably at most a month and a half to come. So that's the state that we are in. Now, given that, I just want to spend a few minutes talking about what supply chain has to be doing in banking. So I'm sure most of you would have had this question in your mind. Why is supply chain part of this banking thing? And why is supply chain most importantly part of the API lifecycle that we have been speaking along with WSO2? First things foremost, we all have to understand that open banking is not only about APIs. I always make this statement. It is pretty less about APIs. It's more about security and trust, which is something that most people don't talk about. So security and trust is the most thing when you speak APIs, primarily because you share information with in your practical world, and when you're meeting people, you share information only with people whom you trust. And if you do not trust them, you do not share the information. You keep some information with you, you do not share that. So the security and the trust architecture, as I call it personally, that's the most important thing in open banking. In fact, much more than APIs, you need to have a trust architecture established before you start opening out your data. This is the essence with which I want to open the session and start getting in. Now, let's experience what we have learned as part of open banking. Before I get into what I am, where I am from, I just wanted to get inside a bit of the context. So a very simple looking supply chain entities on the top left you see here. So that's the first very simple supply chain set of entities. Now, actually, in reality, if you notice, it's a little bit more complex, in fact, much more complex. Every entity here will have their own chain and process of activities. And when you translate that kind of a supply chain to bank, you see the actors will be very similar. You will have consumers, you will have product and service owners. Within consumers itself, you will have the retail individuals like you and me, the SMEs who are small-time entrepreneurs running their own companies, and big-time, mid-sized or large-sized corporates. So within each of these actors, you will find multiple variations. And similarly, the same product and service owners, you will find banks. There are nuances in ATMs where ATMs are being managed by the companies, payment service and payment engine providers. And eventually, I would like to call this as the open banking propellant, which is the complementing product providers, which are not banks, but they would like to tie up with banks to offer innovative products and reach the customers far bit. So this is one aspect. And finally, certainly not the least, is the most important, the invisible element in this entire ecosystem is the regulator. So what I'm actually trying to say here is that every bank has their own ecosystem to operate and manage. Now, this is the most important thing we all have to understand. And this is why it is a supply chain. And we heard from Mifan a while back on the aspect of this entire process chain. And Johan also spoke about the digital supply chain. So I'm not going to be spending too much on that one, too much time on that one. So this is why we need to really understand why the supply chain in this API context is very important for us to manage. How do you actually manage the supply chain? The answer is, by now all of you would have figured out, it is obviously the APIs. APIs play a role of a very good connector, and thereby ensuring safety and security, not only for the consumer, but also for the entire ecosystem. Now, with that, I would like to spend the next minute or so in the digital life cycle. You saw Johan explain the supply chain very nicely in terms of sourcing, manufacturing, distribution, sales, and consumption. This is a very traditional manufacturing supply chain. And he also nicely explained the aspect of when it transforms into a digital life cycle. from discovery, building, deployment, and consume those services, not only from yourself, from outside. Then you have it deployed into your customers' environments. Then you have the customers actually start subscribing to these services, either by way of subscription. I call it personally, I've added this term from my own, where I would like to call this as an acquisition of a customer. Now, this is where it finally translates into experience. Now, every bit of this stage or transfer of information from one stage to another is by way of APIs, and that's how we are going to manage the digital life cycle. So that's how you get the experience, right? We also heard from Dasana about the stage 1 to stage 4 of the open banking maturity, right? So stage 4 is about genuine experience to the end state customer, where the end state customer technically decides the kind of experience they want. Now, that's what you're seeing in the extreme left here. You're seeing a lot of customers accessing the bank's data via third-party apps. Please note that they are not invoking the bank data directly. They are invoking via third-party apps and invoking via the public API layer. Through the public API layer, they are invoking the bank's data. Now, this is the whole traditional shift from directly accessing API. You might have APIs, point-to-point APIs in the past, but it's no longer point-to-point. It's a single API that will be invoked by all the third parties there. So this obviously means there is a lot of standardization that is involved, and there is a lot of security aspects to address. Now, with that introduction to the topic, I'm just going to introduce Intellect also. Intellect is an offshoot of Polaris Software Labs, started way back in the early 90s by a gentleman called Arun Jain. And it was running for some time, and products started coming in starting mid-90s, 95 onwards. So starting the early 2000s, Intellect as a genuine product organization were running as a subsidiary within Polaris. During the year 2013-14, we had demerged, and Intellect Design listed themselves as a genuine product organization as Intellect Design itself. So that was about Intellect Design then. Right now, we are a company which are present in about 91 countries. We have about 250 customers as we speak now, and about $210+ million in revenue. We've been in this banking business, and our focus is only banking, BFSI, banking and financial services and insurance, for the past 25 years. We have multiple units within us. We have the GCB, which is Global Consumer Banking, GTB, which is Corporate Banking, which is Global Transaction Banking, again, Corporate Banking. Then the Risk and Treasury Management, which is primarily that handles the, provides the products for treasury and risk management. And finally, Intellect Seek, which provides insurance product lines. I'm not delving too much into the analyst rating. So you will notice consistently we have been rated number one or number two in all the, most of the analysts have rated us in that vis-a-vis other competitors like Temenos, Finetrex, et cetera, competitors. A little bit about me. You might obviously know my name. I'm Harish. I've been in technology since inception. So for the past 15, 16 years, I've been working as a technocrat and also thinking as a technocrat. I joined Intellect Design way back in 2005. Been working in multiple dimensions of pre-sales, engineering, solution architecture, and delivery too. With that introduction about me, I'm just going to go into why this whole concept of open banking has come in and why is it exciting for us. I'm going to break this down into three sections. The first section is a little bit of a why. I'm just requesting all of you to wear the hat of a very simple banking consumer and just think to yourself on a few questions to answer on your own. How many of you have wished that your bank offered you more value? How many of you, when you have interacted with the bank, felt that, I don't know banking and that's why I'm struggling? How many of you felt the need for account portability? How many of you felt your money is not giving you enough? How many of you felt that when you are buying something from a merchant, the payment mechanism being offered is extremely cumbersome and it's unsafe? I don't know whether I should trust my bank or not. So many questions, right? And this is only a small set of questions. So what we exactly need now is we need to understand and accept the fact that we really don't need to know banking to be a customer. Why do we need to know the accounting? Why do we know to be GL entries? Why do we need to know those things within a bank? We don't need to know that. First of all, we need to understand and we need to put our head high. We need to put our head a little high and say that we need to be respected as consumers. We don't want to be sticking to the bank because we should be having other banks to move to. If we don't like a bank, we should be ready. And much like the mobile number portability, we should be able to move across banks very easily. And if more importantly, if somebody else is able to offer financial services which are complementing, for instance, I still do not have a place where I can see all my accounts in one place. I do not have that. Now, if somebody else is able to do that, I should be able to engage their services very fast. And so what in essence we are trying to say is that we'll need a fast and a safe banking model. That's what we require. To do that, what is the actual solution? Open banking is one solution that people have thought. It's not that it's an overnight solution. People have come across multiple designs, so they have thought about. And the most important thing about open banking is about sharing of information, right? So you share the information. So you decide what to share. You decide you want to share your account information. You decide you want to share your transactionary information. And the bank also can decide to share their open data. When we say open data, it means their product information. I'm not sure how many of you have seen this Bank Bazaar, Policy Bazaar, etc., that compares the different products and tells the customer saying that this is the best suited product for you. Now, that's one of the benefit of something like an open banking. Olden days, it's not that people did not offer this earlier. When all these Policy Bazaars, Bank Bazaars came in first, it was screen scraping technique that it used to be. And we all know that it's most of them are vulnerable for security flaws and all the other hackings that happen all around the world. Now, with that kind of a sharing mechanism, I'm sure you and me will not be running behind those kind of third-party service providers. Now, if you are able to provide a solution which is API-driven, when we say API-driven, we as consumers don't need to understand, but when the solution is implemented as an API-driven, all the vulnerabilities and the performance problems that others have been facing will no longer be there. That's the advantage of going the API way. And that's the advantage of helping the third parties offer and complete the next milestone to reach the customer with the information, with the product that they actually want. Now, this is what we are calling as a universal product bundling by complementing financial products that creating financial products that banks otherwise cannot offer. So therefore, the customer becomes much more aware. In the latest world, it's about financial awareness, right? So all of us should be equally understanding about the financial products that exist in the world because it's about money and we need more money for the future. Now, so that's where the information asymmetry between the bank and the consumer is actually reducing. So that's the advantage you get and that's the solution you get when you do something like an open banking. So all this boils down to two primary aspects of the platform. You need APIs, and in case APIs, I mean a standard set of APIs that are consumable by anybody and everybody. At the same time, make sure the customer's information is kept sacrosanct and share only what is required and share only to authenticated and authorized users. With that, I would like to get into the experience between Intellect and WSO2 and the experience that we have had in implementing open banking in a large subsidiary of a UK bank. It's part of the CMNA, Competition and Markets Authority 9 bank. This bank is a large bank that was selected for open banking a while back, and they had selected Intellect to implement their digital transformation along with their core banking. Now, the bank had chosen Intellect already to implement digital banking, core banking, and payments. When they came to us and said that we need open banking also to be done, because that's the biggest tick mark for compliance. So Intellect readily accepted, and we started looking out for different kind of solution models. So what is the solution model? One option, obviously, was to build it on our own. We knew the complexities that is involved in that building of our own model. And we kind of decided, and based on different options that are available, we kind of decided that we want to be taking an open banking component solution, which is available in the market, and hook it on top of our existing core, which was already API first. While that said, there were multiple options. Personally, at some point in time, I had discussed with WSO2 a while back, so I knew WSO2 had an open banking solution. And when we saw that, we decided that this is going to be the solution simply because the components were flexible enough to either run independently or to be hooked onto our API, our private APIs that we already had. The second one that we were really impressed is the amount of information and knowledge base that WSO2 had, and the public documentation that the entire WSO team is coming up with makes sure that we are fully self-dependent and we reach out to WSO2 only in case of exceptions. Now, that was the reason why we had originally worked with, decided to work with WSO2, and it holds good till today. Now, with that little bit of a background, the problem domain was clear. We had to implement open banking, and what we required was experience in open banking, expertise in open banking, and technical brilliance. And we found that in the WSO2 products and the entire team that we interacted with. So finally, the problem that we, if you define that problem in a context, we required an API bolt-on engine with built-in OIDC Connect capabilities, and that's able to get past the certification test from a functional standpoint and a performance standpoint. So we then started our journey with WSO2. So where we are now, I'm going to go for a change from the bottom to the top. Where we are now, I just want to acknowledge this architecture, the holistic architecture that we presented to OBIE, which is the governing body within UK. They had remarked during a presentation that this architecture was by far the best technical presentation ever that they have seen. So this was a remark that was said by the OBIE lead who were meeting us for the first time. We are currently live on OBIE API version 3. So technically, we are also live on the version 4, but we haven't yet tested that in production. So we are holding on. In terms of the number of APIs, we are 16 plus APIs that are close to 23 APIs in version 4. But we are since we are on version 3, we are live on 16 plus APIs. Even without the or not all the customers in the bank in production, we have already onboarded around close to 11 third parties in the WSO2 open banking platform that are able to integrate into our banking platform and collect information about customers already. So this is something that we have done in the last 1.5 to 2 months, and this was possible because of the architecture that we have deployed to the bank. Now, we are expecting that this will get to 20 to 25 in the near future. Within the next quarter, we are expecting this number to be around 25. And we are working with WSO2 to create a similar offering for UK into the Berlin Group standards that's required by Switzerland, Germany, and a few other countries within the Eurozone. So we are looking at Sweden with immediate effect. So we are in discussions with WSO2 to take this forward. I'm not going to dwell too much into the first topic. I think I have already mentioned that. One of the primary things that I wanted to assert is that the technical teams within WSO2 and the quick start programs that they are offering are of real high class. To that extent, I just wanted to quote one experience here. When I first met a few people from the WSO2 team during the quick start program that they had offered, I was worried that whatever information that we had given would get lost in the subsequent months to come. I was pleasantly surprised 3 months later when we got back again for the final discovery touches. I was really pleasantly surprised that the team had remembered whatever we had discussed with them, and they had played back every word of what we had told as part of our complexities. So this was a pleasant surprise and a real thank you to WSO2. And the product that we are currently using is the API Manager. We are using Identity Access Manager too. We are also using their analytics and reporting capabilities. So with that, I'm going to the next solution context, a very simple solution context diagram that I had just prepared to outline. You have the WSO2 components highlighted in orange. You have the Intellect components, which is there in blue. You have the banks components, which we are interfacing with in the in gray. So what the point I'm trying to say is that this is a WSO2's components is a bolt-on, It's got a built-in security profile management. We are fully aware of that. It's completely FAPI grade certified. The point I wanted to emphasize here is that please recollect back to my first slide where I said that every bank has an ecosystem to manage. Now, with this platform and Intellect's capabilities, we are now able to handle all the systems that the bank has and make it almost like a marketplace. So this is what we are managing. We are managing the ecosystem where this API manager and Intellect's APIs, they interact with all these systems and post the transactions. So this is the extent of the solution context and architecture that I wanted to outline. Just a bit more brief, the APIs are of two primary types or three primary types, I should say. One is the AISP, which is the read-only API resources. You have the write resize, write API resources, which post transactions. And the third one is an interesting, my favorite is the open data. So all the open data that the bank is offering, get that. So these are the three types of APIs that we have configured in this one. Now this architecture seems simple, where it will be seem very simple, and we have simplified this while depicting, but the actual configure. Thanks to WSO2 for helping me prepare this one. So this WSO2, this diagram. And all this is being done. So you see about the 21 steps. I do not have time to navigate to all the 20 plus steps that you're seeing here. Close to 21 steps to execute one single API from a third party. So if you want to know the balance of a customer, you need to pass through 21 steps. The brief bit of access points is here. If you notice, the one of the key reasons why I keep saying that it is much less about API, it's a lot more about the identity server here that you're seeing. This is the key for entire open banking. I will say open banking is much more than APIs. It's close to 60% of the open banking has to be managed within the identity server. The beauty of the component is that it's able to interact with the internet banking portal that we have provided, and it is also able to interact with the identity manager that we already had. One of the primary considerations that we had given as a requirement to WSO2 was that they interface with our identity management solution, which is the customer identity manager. I think Johan spoke about CIAM from WSO2, right? So that's something that we already had within our platform, and we did not want to replace that, and therefore we wanted the WSO2's identity server to interface with our identity server, which is ARX, and we were able to do that with only configurations and no customization. That's the beauty of the entire platform, I will say. With that architecture, with this security and trust architecture, as I call it, we are able to get all the security profiles that you're seeing here fully certified by OBIE. We are now certified for OBIE Open Banking Security Profile. We are certified for Financial Grade API certified. We are also certified for the back channel authentication. So this is the beauty of the entire architecture I wanted to emphasize on. Let me spend a minute or two on this one. I like to call this cause and effect or effect of the cause. This is more from an impact certified. We are completely compliant with all the specifications that OBIE had mandated the bank to get in. So we are fully compliant, and therefore we are able to say that we are fully sandbox ready and production ready. We are waiting for all the customers to come into the platform to declare a full-fledged go live. As I said earlier, we are 10 TPPs already onboarded. We are in talks with a lot more along with the bank. And just a point in the future, while I think Dasan also mentioned this a while back, that compliance is a key driver for open banking adoption. Now, user conformance was the key objective for the last year. 2021 is the year for expansion and monetization. And I'm just gladly announcing that with the WSO2 components, we are ready for expansion and monetization as we speak. So when the bank is wanting to start price their APIs and charge their TPPs or customers, they are ready to do so with this platform. Now that's the impact that we have created. How we have created that impact, just to give you a benefit in terms of effort and cost, I will also give you a contrasting information. So we, from the bank side, we have a 4-member PMO and a testing team, and a 5-member technical team from Intellect. So this is the only engineering teams and the project management teams that we have. We are completely backed by the best-in-class WSO2 technical teams, be it their product expertise, be it their support teams. We are fully being supported by them. Till today, in terms of efficiency, just to give you, we've just faced less than 5 production issues till date, and that too as a deviation. Most of them were deviations from the specification standard, which we had to deal with OBIE for closure. Now, with this kind of an operational excellence, I think this is the reason why we are able to proudly say that Intellect and WSO2 have delivered the promise of open banking to the bank. Genuine success drivers. Key success driver is the open banking ready platforms that WSO2 has been providing. We spent almost close to 45 days initially during the Quick Start program, extended Quick Start program also, to make sure that we all understand. And one of the key objectives was to make sure that we are independent and we are completely dependent on WSO2 for implementation of and making changes and configuration. So that was the intent during USP, and we were able to achieve that. Extreme collaboration with the teams, especially during the go live stages and during the version changes that kept happening. We started with version 1, we had to move to version 2, then to 3, and now we are on track for moving to 4 without any dependence on WSO2. Excellent technical skills from the WSO2 team side and the Intellect side also. Both the teams worked very well and complemented each other in terms of knowledge and going to the next level. Attitude and intent was real high class. So this was the key driver for us. The last but not certainly the one of the things, and my favorite also, is the class of documentation from the WSO2 site. So we have, I'm just giving you reference on docs.wso2.com. Most of you will know this. One of the things that you may not know, that WSO2 already publishes the security advisories, which means that as a product organization, they are much adapted doing and also aware of what's happening in the market in terms of security and the non-functional aspects. So they keep doing the tests and the vulnerability tests and keeps giving advisories and link it back to all their customers and deployment. So that's a real success driver for us. And finally, because we also said earlier about this regulation and compliance, this being compliance, the changes keep coming. So we are in version 3, we'll move to version 4. Every quarter or 6 months, the versions are going to change. And using this platform, it gives me real confidence to say that much of the changes that we are doing in the configuration side. We are not making changes or customization to the core. With that message, I would like to just showcase you what we have done in terms of the NFR, the non-functional aspect. What we had targeted was about close to 1.5 APIs per second and 100 APIs per minute. What we have achieved is about close to 13 APIs per second and 800 plus APIs per minute. Mind you, this is end-to-end. This is not only the WSO2 platform. This is the integration within our core, and this is the integration within the payment platform. So we have included all the APIs that are there, and all the 16 APIs have been benchmarked for this information, and this is live in production. This is based on the production response that we are seeing. So that's the essence of what we have seen. Both WSO2's components and this are lightweight components, I will say. And you see the memory utilization here from the API point, it's only at 22%. So this is the impact of the component here. And we are extremely confident now that this will scale, and any number of TTPs that are going to come, we will be able to scale. That's the message that we are carrying forward with this. A quick look at the connectors that we have provided. We have engineered together with the component using WSO2's components. As I said earlier, split into three types of APIs. One is the account and transaction APIs. The other is the payment APIs. The third one is the open data APIs. ATM APIs are not applicable for this bank because this bank is a digital branchless bank, and therefore there are no ATMs that they own, and therefore they don't have to submit. They don't have to be compliant with this API. BCA is the business current account product. PCA is personal current account product. So information about these products will be given as open data. The payment APIs are straightforward. You get to post a domestic payment. Either it could be within the bank or outside the bank. There are APIs to post internationally, but we are not we've not exposed that. The last but not the least, it's the read APIs, close to 11 APIs, starting from account handle requests till the list of transactions for a specific account. So we have provided so many APIs and all this using WSO2's API manager, where we have hosted all these APIs and they have been proxied with the private APIs that we offer from our core banking system.